Thanks for clicking through to Chamber Web TV. These are one-on-one interviews with business and political leaders in our community. And right here in our Chamber studios is a good friend of mine, former boss of mine. My good friend, Helen Jowett, who owns McDonald Green Consulting as well in town, but has also recently announced that she wants to step into the world of politics. So not only do we have a business leader from our community, we also have maybe potentially a political leader. Helen, wonderful to see you.
Thanks, Greg.
It's always great to have a conversation with you. Sometimes it's on the phone, sometimes it's late in the day. But you know, I guess that's what I've always really enjoyed about you is our conversations have been fun, friendly, but very concise in talking about issues of the day.
Absolutely.
And you know, you have a long history in this community. Of course, you grew up in this community. Mm-hmm. And what led you to where you are today in business? Let's talk about your business, first of all.
Okay. Human resources has always been of interest to me. I've always kind of been curious about why people do the jobs they do. It just was one of those things that I knew I had a natural curiosity about. Mm-hmm. So I took bookkeeping first, like everybody did back then as a female, and then I started to realize how good performing employees could actually affect the bottom line of a business. Now, it's a fairly strong concept, but I kind of worked through my history, and then when the time was right, I had great support from my husband, I opened my business, and got a lot of great opportunities from the business to be able to learn about.
Well, was that kind of your goal in the very beginning? You wanted to be kind of your own boss? You wanted to have your own thing?
It wasn't intentionally. If I had to be honest, looking back now, my mother was an entrepreneur, and she was very entrepreneurial in the way that she behaved, and it was fun to watch her. I learned a lot about networking from my mom, and then because she was in real estate, mm-hmm. and had her own business. So I didn't realize I wanted to be entrepreneurial until the opportunity presented itself when, Mark and I had paid off our first home, and I said, I'd really like to try this. And he said, okay, let's do it. So
nothing like having strong support from your spouse to say, yeah, go ahead and do it.
I'm very fortunate.
Yes, you are, because he's now doing the same thing with you running for political office. Yeah, go ahead and do it.
He absolutely is.
No, that's really good. I know Mark very well, too. He's a great guy, and, you two are a great couple. And I think Mark is almost the opposite of what you traditionally see. You know, Mark is that very supportive spouse, behind the scenes, and wants you to be that face and voice of not just your business and your family, but of your community too. And you've done that even through business. Helen, you've been chair of both chambers of commerce in the region of Waterloo.
I wasn't actually chair.
Oh, yes, you were on the executive.
I was on the executive, you're right. And then I had a choice at the
That's
time.
That's right, I remember that.
Right, yeah. Kitchener had suggested it, and you had suggested it, and I thought, you know what, I'd really like to go with Cambridge. Mm-hmm. That's where I'm from, and so I'm glad I did.
But you chaired Junior Achievement Program, which actually came out of the chamber movement way, 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 way back.
Loved it.
Yes, did a great job there. You are currently the chair of Canada's Technology Triangle, the regional foreign direct investment economic development organization.
Been on that board for 10 years, learned a lot about the economy, economic development, our capital assets in the community, being able to present them to other people.
And you know, so what's really interesting is Junior Achievement is largely about, you know, kids, of course, programs in the school, but really talking about entrepreneurial stuff and how to be business oriented. And CTT, of course, is all business oriented. It's about attracting new businesses, mm-hmm. here from outside of the country, actually, to our region to locate and create jobs and all that kind of stuff. But you also led the Community Hospital Foundation as well.
I did.
Which is really on the other side of all of that. Really the heartbeat of the social services of our community, healthcare.
What a great experience that was to remind me of, some of the other issues that hit the average family in the community. And I took that very seriously. When I was invited at a really critical time for the hospital, and I really found that opened up my mind to, a lot of the members of our community that are suffering, mm-hmm. and I think that really broadened my perspective for sure. I mean, I was already sort of understanding that because, I'm in the business of helping people get jobs, and some people who are getting jobs in our sort of sort of temporary division, are struggling to get jobs. And especially, this is my third recessionary economic cycle, so I know that it's a cyclical thing, but people feel the pain of that, you know? And so I've watched that pain and lived that pain with other people. I mean, some occupations are sort of insulated from it, but a lot of our members of the community have felt pain, and we need to be continuing to look at how we can service them better.
And so from that all the way to vice chair of the board for Conestoga College, our great institution that just built a magnificent building right here in our own community.
Oh, Conestoga College is a definite capital asset. I'm proud of the work they do. They remind us that we need to make things. The GDP success is contingent upon us recognizing making things is still a very critical function. Working with John on understanding that not only do we have a demographic shift that's going to create a people gap out there to be able to do jobs, and I know we don't feel it right now because of the recession, but the skills gap. We need to understand what business needs from people so that we can all fit these little pieces together for prosperity or to succeed in our community.
You know, what I think is interesting about your candidacy for regional council is, you know, one of the aspects, I think if, it, and you and I were talking a little earlier about this, one of the things is that people would look at as not being an issue, but being a concern to them, is the economy and jobs. And, you know, your background in human resource, running your own business, being through three cyclical downturns in our economy, you've been at the front lines of seeing, you know, that depletion of jobs and then the creation of jobs too, because some of those recessions you were through had big booms coming out where couldn't find enough people, you know, and then we do have the skilled, you know, shortage, and you're a part of an institution that's really working hard to say, you know, doctors and lawyers and accountants are really, really good, but boy, oh boy, we need people to run machines and to lay bricks and to build houses and all of those kinds of things.
Fix plumbing.
And fix plumbing, absolutely. Yeah. So, you know, I guess from my perspective, that really gives you a true professional outlook on where we're going as a broader community from a jobs creation perspective and a economic development perspective.
I worry. This particular recession's been long, and people have felt it for a long time. I think that we're at a crossroad right now, Greg, where this community has so many good things about it that we have, and we have such great collaboration that happens with regard to business and government and education, and I think we have to continue on and recognize that it's getting very competitive out there. You know, it's for communities to come out of a recession is when everybody gets real competitive. And so we have to be smart about that. It's smart about recognizing our you know, the great things about our community and making sure we're selling them to the outer world so we can get that investment coming in and making sure we're still developing the talents and skills of our general population so they can fill those jobs. You know, people are working, businesses are growing, they're hiring more people. I just want to make sure that I'm taking whatever I can contribute to get that right, to keep people working, get more people working, get business growing.
You know, did you ever think you'd be a politician?
I didn't really look at it that way, you know.
And you're really not now. Even when we have conversations about it, you're not talking about it as being a politician. You're talking about it as approaching, gee, we got some serious issues in our region. Maybe some of them are relationship issues that you have a fantastic ability to be able to develop relationships, and that's probably your networking experience and your running your own business experience. But, you know, it's not about being a politician for you, it's about contributing back to the community you love.
Well, it is, and I do believe one of the strengths I do have is facilitating. I believe in creating an environment where people can play devil's advocacy. You know, that's what works in business, and it served me well, and I know when I've worked with other people, you have a stronger relationship if you're able to talk about the stuff that's different about you as well, or your differences of opinion, and I think that's where we need to go next. In order to harness all the intelligence in our community and the greatness, we need to talk about those openly, and we need to talk about some of the stuff we gotta look at a little critically.
I think I remember back to the time for 2 years when you were my board chair, and you know, we would have conversations just about every day about things, and you know, and I of course would be hot under the collar with something. Happened maybe too often, but I find as I get older, I'm getting a little more cynical about things. But you know, you were that one to say, "Wait a minute, Greg, let's step back. You know, is that the right approach? Is that Is that the message we want to send, or, you know, should we be forming that message to, you know, to make sure that, you know, we're not looking like, you know, bad baggage?
Yeah. Well, and we did. We played devil's advocacy well, mm-hmm. and I think it served us well. And I do believe that a lot of people out there, that's how they want to look at things now. Like, let's be honest about where we're going and what we have to offer and maybe what we need to do better. We have some great community assets here. You know, mm-hmm. you spoke of the college. You know, we've got those great universities that are all within, you know, 15, mm-hmm. 20 minutes. I mean, people envy that mm-hmm. stuff. We've got this wonderful 401 that runs through and creates great opportunity from a business perspective. Mm-hmm. We just have to sort out some of our little housekeeping issues.
Yeah, right? Well, and they're important issues. You know, I guess one of my passion ones, and one that you share a concern with because you're now chair of CTT, but, you know, the loss of some of the jobs surrounding BlackBerry, which is a real big concern. You know, yeah. we have a lot of people in Cambridge that have been laid off from BlackBerry. And, you know, it's not, you can throw blame game around all you want, but that's not the important issue. The important issue is, so what are we going to do with these folks that are unemployed? And then we have, you know, at the other end of the scale, you go from high-tech BlackBerry all the way down to Maple Leaf and the loss of Schneider's to Hamilton. And, you know, maybe that's not too far away, but boy, for that type of job, it's a long ways away, and a lot of people won't move, so they just lose those jobs. And, you know, that's really important to us, you know, that whole thing. You know, we shouldn't lose those businesses. We should do what we can to help those businesses. And I think, you know, hopefully you're positioned well with your experiences, because I think I neglected to mention to people, you also sat on the Barn Raisers, which is a
that's
a really neat organization mm-hmm. that's really high level thinking about what can we do? What can the region be?
Well, I took it a great compliment when David Johnson sort of selected me to join the group of wonderful people that are sitting around that table. And they do. They think through some real complex issues. So we're lucky to have that kind of collaboration. I don't know if a lot of people know about some of the stuff that goes on in the community that's based on trying to extrapolate all the best things and solve some of our bigger issues. So, yeah, like, it is a great organization. Maple Leaf was a sad loss. You know, I was vice chair of CTT mm-hmm. When that sort of came about, and it was sad. It was sad for the community, and it was sad for everybody else that was engaged, and a lot of people had to take a long, hard look at themselves and say, what did I do to, you know, mm-hmm. not keep this thing here, you know? And that's one of the reasons I got engaged. I could see that we need more of this barrier removal to sustain ourselves, to stop losing good companies, to make sure that we create an environment that not just for foreign direct investment, but that ecosystem right here at home that yeah. lets our own businesses continue to grow and develop and create more. And again, at the end of the day, create more jobs.
Mm-hmm. Well, 80% of our growth is going to come from the companies that are here today. And,
absolutely.
You know, we absolutely have to be mindful of that. And it's very expensive to do the foreign direct investment thing. You know, you throw an awful lot of money at something before you get some good come out of it. It's still, you have to do it, but there's no question about it. But a real concerted effort needs to be focused on our existing businesses and helping them through tough times, but also helping them grow when they need to grow as well. But, you know, you know, I don't want to get too much into politics right now, Helen, because we're going to have many more interviews
okay.
on this subject. But, but I, you know, I certainly wanted people to see your personality and understand, you know, who you are and what you are. But we should talk a little bit about, you know, you haven't really done your platform or really out of the gate. It's way, way early before the campaign. So, you know, you're really not, you know, sitting there with notes in front of you about what your platform is. But what are some things that you'd like to contribute, being an elected member from Cambridge, represented at the regional council?
So I have some fairly strong sort of perspectives, certainly on jobs. Jobs has always been at the forefront of my engagement mm-hmm. at some of these leadership tables. I always know that we got to have lots of jobs here. That's what keeps us a growing and healthy population, and it affords us the ability to look after some of the, you know, some of the constituents that need a little bit more help, and we should be proud of those kinds mm-hmm. of things. So jobs are critically important to me. This community, Cambridge, is, I mean, I've seen it change over the last 50 years. Oh, did I say that out loud? You know, and I love that we've been able to harness and capitalize on our strengths, and I want to see us do even more, again, as we hit this critical juncture coming out of this recession, which has been a little longer than the previous ones. You know, I just want to make sure we just harness everything that is afforded us and go straight forward. Certainly, I've got some opinions about LRT, and I want to express that, you know, infrastructure is important to a community, and it's important to continue to build on infrastructure and look at the investment of infrastructure and how it impacts the future. I do believe that our taxpayers here in Cambridge have to be respected, and we have to start looking at what they need to be able to pay for and what they can tolerate paying for, especially in economic recovery. Certainly, you know, I have some strong opinions about where we go from here when it comes to economic development. You know, how do we not look at it from a broader perspective? I mean, not just, you're right, the foreign direct investment's one piece of it, but how do we develop best practices to continue to support our businesses that are here and allow and enable and encourage growth and development in those businesses so that we can continue this, sustaining this, you know, this greatness that's here, you know. And again, recessionary times when the purse tightens are exactly those times when we need to invest in our recovery, you know. And you remember the old adage, Greg, when times were tough, they'd lay off all the salespeople, right? Yeah. And they'd stop training and developing. And then people got smart and started realizing, no, that's when you
need to invest,
right?
Yeah.
I think that's where we are as a community, coming out of this economic strife that we've all experienced. I think we need to really take a good long look at how we move forward so we can get the best of
how do you feel about you know, you've been, you mentioned earlier and we talked a little bit about it, that you went through three cycles of downturns and back up again, and one of those was a pretty fast surge out, like we had crazy growth, like double-digit growth coming out
from
of
from 94 to 97,
yeah,
just when I started my business. I started in recession by 97. I was booming.
Yeah.
I remember it well.
Couldn't find people yourself to work. I remember you telling me those
stories.
So what do you think? We've obviously been really slow getting out of this one. Probably a little bit too slow. But would you prefer to see a slower move out as opposed to that big, fast bang out? I know, let's not be selfish.
The race.
There's a really good one. You know, I guess the selfish part of me would say, no, I want 10% growth tomorrow. But is that the right thing?
Well, it's kind of, I look at it like business, you know, it is what it is. So whatever's in front of us, let's recognize that.
Mm-hmm.
If it's a slow trajectory of growth or a slow growth period, then that enables us to be able to be really thoughtful about our actions.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if it's fast, you're almost just putting out fires and responding.
Yeah.
So it's like the opportunity is there in both scenarios, but it is what it is. It's a slow growth.
Mm-hmm.
So then that tells me that let's make policy, you know, a part of the enabling process.
Very good.
Right?
Yes,
let's get
absolutely.
People engaged in recognizing it's a cycle, although we can never forget that people feel these cycles.
Yes.
They feel it in their homes. They feel it in their lives and how they move forward. And you know, there's depression and a myriad of issues around it. But at the end of the day, if it is what it is, then let's just do the best we can with what's in front of us. Let's get good policy to enable and engage. You know, let's support our education system to bring out the best in employees so that they can be marketable and get good jobs, and they can help business grow and be strong. You know, let's attract more business here because it's all working. It's very much interconnected.
I think, you know, really what you're kind of saying is we, you know, if we work really hard at it and we work smart at it, we can grow out of this ourselves. You know, we don't have to worry necessarily about the global economy. You know, we can create those opportunities right here if we have really good, optimistic, and sensible approach to things. And I think that's what you're saying you could bring to Regional Council.
I think so, yes.
Yeah.
I think that's, well, you know, I'm hoping to sort of bring some...
I might be a little biased because, you know, we have a little fun thing that I'm Helen's big brother. I don't know, it's really nice to have a really smart sister, though, I can tell you that much.
Greg, that means a lot.
What do you mean it means a lot? You were brilliant, you were a wonderful chair of the Chamber of Commerce, and your friendship it means more to me than probably anything, and you're one of my... favorite people on the planet.
It's definitely
so.
Two-way, my friend.
Yeah,
definitely,
well, it's great. And Helen, you know, we're going to have lots more conversations. I'm going to get a little tougher as it goes on.
All right.
You know,
I'll
but
get myself ready.
not too tough, but still in all, you know, certainly I know from the chamber's perspective, you know, we're really proud to see our past chair wanting to lead the community in different ways. And not that you'll always see eye to eye necessarily with the chamber, because that's not what a politician does, but we certainly know that you are thoughtful in your process about making decisions, and you always seem to make the right decision, certainly for the broader aspect. You've never, to me, struck me as being an individual that's looking after Helen Jowett's best interest. You always consider everybody else, and I think that's really what we need in leadership at the political level today. So congratulations, Kim.
Thanks, Greg. That means a lot. Appreciate it.
And I know you're going to do really, really well. So we'll talk soon.
Okay.
There you go, ladies and gentlemen. Helen Jowett running for regional council for the city of Cambridge. One of two spots she's running for, of course, for the fall election. And we're certainly proud of her here. And this has given you an opportunity to meet her, Helen Jowett.